All right, well, welcome. This is week six of Ratio Christi. My name is Joshua Butler. I'm really excited to be here. I'm a local pastor here in Portland, Oregon. And today we're going to be looking at kind of the tough topic of holy war and violence in the Old Testament. Welcome, come on in. We're wanting to take some time. This is, if you guys are like me, I found this is a really tough topic that lots of people grapple with, kind of violence, particularly in the Old Testament. How do we make sense of some of it? And we want to look today particularly at what's going on with Israel and Canaan. Some have referred to this as genocide even. Is that what's going on? Big picture, I found many of us fear, I think the holy war is kind of like the skeleton in God's closet, right? Like this tough topic where I think the fear is we kind of open up the closet doors, we open up scripture and look, I think the fear is that we find that God is not truly good or worthy of our trust. But I found that's because I think we often have kind of a caricature of what's actually going on in the biblical story. So one of the things I want to try and do today is offer some paradigm shifts that have helped me over the years to just kind of hopefully reclaim a healthier, more robust understanding of what's going on, where we can see this topic arising because of the goodness of God, not in spite of it or in contradiction to it. Or at the end of the day, I'm not so much hoping to be the answer man that's got it all figured out, anything like that, but more at end game would be that we could reclaim a deeper confidence in the goodness of God, that God is good all the way down in his very bones. So, that said, what I'm kind of wondering in this first half of the talk is trying to go, what's the overarching story that's going on here? And then in the second half, I want to take a look at what I like to call maybe the drastic marching orders, some of the tough commands that Israel is given. So let's kind of start, though, by going, what is the overarching storyline here? I think if most of us hear when we hear the language of holy war and we think of holy warriors, if you're like me, I tend to think of something like this, right? Like Rambo, I grew up on, Rambo, and what I mean by that is I think we tend to think of like the muscle-bound machine gun heroes, right? And that I think often the image that we have of holy warriors that comes to mind is, they're muscle-bound. These are people who are strong, they've got strength, they've been training for battle. These are folks with machine guns in terms of advanced weaponry. Like even you think of 9/11 and even though they, being able to actually weaponize a plane, even though they maybe didn't have massive armies, they were able to take something unexpected and accomplish just mass destruction with it. So they've got advanced weaponry and they see themselves as heroes, right? Like holy warriors often believe they're justified in fighting because of the greatness of their civilization or their ideology, whatever they're kind of going to bat for. And so at the end of the day, I think we tend to think of holy war as the strong using God or the gods to justify their conquest of the weak. We tend to think of it as the strong using God to justify their conquest of the weak. But I would suggest that in the biblical story, it's actually moving the opposite direction. That this is actually God arising on behalf of the weak against the tyranny of the strong when it's raged for far too long. That this is God arising on behalf of the weak against the tyranny of the strong. And so I think one of the first questions we have to ask is like, who are the warriors here? And as we look at Israel, they are not who you would expect. They are a nation of ragtag slaves who have been getting their tails kicked by the empire, on the outskirts of the empire, for centuries. And they are going up against the mightiest imperial powerhouses of the ancient world. This is not the strong going up against the weak, this is the weak going up against the strong. And what I want to do now is kind of use each of these categories and show how muscle-bound, machine gun, and heroes, Israel actually takes each of these in the Old Testament and flips them upside down on their head. That what we normally think of as holy war, Israel's not just kind of changing a few things in a few different directions, that the Old Testament story is actually taking this mainstream understanding of holy war and flipping it upside down on its head, giving us a radically different picture. So let's start with machine guns, okay? The idea of advanced, obviously they didn't have machine guns back then, right? But the idea of advanced weaponry, right? Like the sense that they've got kind of advanced weapons. Israel, we find, is contrary to having advanced weapons, we find that Israel is radically outgunned and outmanned as she goes up against Canaan. It's kind of obvious, like there was no sort of stockpile of AK-47s waiting out in the wilderness as Israel came out of Egypt. So Canaan, we see, has horses and chariots, which in the ancient world were like tanks and jet fighters, right? Like Egypt and Canaan have like the most advanced weaponry of the ancient world. Israel, in contrast, has by and large like whatever sticks and stones and things they've been able to muddle together in the wilderness, and probably some pretty shoddy weapons that they've been able to muster somewhere, right? It's just Israel is like a kindergartner taking on the high school senior class with a wiffle bat. Right? She's outgunned, she's outmanned, she's the small, weak, going up against these empires that are armed to the teeth. If we also think of defenses, Canaan has mighty, massive defense systems. She has cities like Jericho, these fortified outposts that are designed to protect from incoming invasion. Israel's defense system, in contrast, is a small wooden box that she built in the desert. The significance, the Ark of the Covenant, is that God's presence goes with her. Israel's only defense and hope is that God arises to defend and protect her. If we think of like generals or military leadership, Canaan has generals who have practiced their strategy on the surrounding nations. They have conquered and assimilated nations into their growing powerhouse structures. Israel, in contrast, her leaders have been fending off snakes in the wilderness and trying to keep the people alive. If we think about armor, Canaan has high-tech metal and sort of the most advanced armor in all of the ancient world. Israel, we're told, is wearing the same ratty clothes that she's been wandering around in the desert in for 40 years. Israel is storming Fort Knox with the water pistol. And we think about the warriors themselves. Canaan is depicted as a land of giants who have been feasting on the milk, land of milk and honey, for generations. And so they have kind of wealth and affluence and the psychological confidence and strength that brings. Israel, in contrast, is depicted as a relative nation of runts who have been living off of bread and water, kind of prison food, in the desert for 40 years. The manna, kind of the bread from heaven and water from rocks. There's a sense she's been in survival mode, eking out a living in the wilderness. So Israel marches into Canaan like ants under elephants' feet. So I suggest that if we want to think about kind of this category of machine guns of advanced weaponry, what Israel has looks less like this and more like this, right? Like Israel goes in radically outgunned, outmanned, and if we kind of think of the NFL as an analogy, it's not that the one is kind of a slightly higher ranked team and the other is like slightly lesser ranked. This is more like the NFL Super Bowl champions going up against your local high school peewee football league team, right? Like they're in a radically different league altogether in terms of numbers, in terms of firepower. Okay, and we see this in Psalm 20 as an example. This is we see this verse show up in a number of places where it's kind of like Israel's battle cry, her theme song. And some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Oh man, Egypt and Canaan and the ancient powerhouses have got chariots and horses. They've got high-tech military defenses and weaponry, but our confidence is not in that stuff. It's in the name of God who goes with us. All right, well, let's move on. So we've seen Israel doesn't have machine guns, but is she muscle bound? And I would suggest no. She doesn't have, by this I mean like strength and strategy. She doesn't have strength and strategy on her side. So we tend to think of holy warriors as those who have been trained for the battle and getting ready for the fight and all that. And they've got their strategies lined up. And Israel, in contrast, her strategies seem ridiculous. Like over and over and over again, they are constantly depicted as ridiculous. So we take Jericho as an example. Jericho's kind of the first battle on the way into Canaan, this large, this fortified military outpost, armed to the teeth, this defensive system, and you see Joshua and Israel come up to it, and they're kind of waiting on God. Okay, God, what's the battle strategy? And they wait for it, and eventually God brings it, and says, all right, here's the plan. I want you to march around the walls for 7 days and blow trumpets, right? That is a dumb battle strategy. That is a ridiculous battle strategy, right? But I think it's significant. I think part of the imagery here is that Israel's going in not armed to the teeth, but in a posture of worship and trusting God to be the one that takes down the imperial walls. And And so, I mean, if you think of the analogy of the Allied forces in World War II, like storming the beaches of Normandy, but with like rock guitars and drums instead of instruments, it would be outrageous. It would be almost laughable, right? If it wasn't so tragic. But here, Israel's going and trusting God to be the one who fights on her behalf. We also see the classic story of Gideon, where these ridiculous battle strategies, it's not like a one-time thing. It is the constant pattern throughout Israel's experience with Canaan. So we look at Gideon, and in context here now, Israel's been in the land for a while, and the Midianites, kind of these forces of Canaan, it says that they rallied all their troops and forces, and they were as many as the sand on the seashore, and their goal was to take out Israel. And so this one is depicted as a defensive battle for Israel. It's kind of like when they were back in Egypt, and now they're being oppressed by these mighty powerhouses in the area. And so, man, okay, God, Gideon, you know, and so God calls Gideon, and Gideon's depicted as like the least in his family, and his family is like the last in the nation, and is in their tribe, and their tribe is like the weakest in the nation. So we see this picture again where God goes to the last and the least and the weakest. Like when it's time for a revolution, God goes to the underdog on the outskirts and calls out Gideon and makes him the leader. So Gideon rallies kind of as many troops and all as he can, and he ends up having number 32,000. So Gideon's able to rally 32,000 troops. So he's like, all right, we're still way outnumbered. We've got 32,000. So God, what is the battle strategy? How are we going to take on these sand on the seashore militias with these 32,000? And so they wait for the battle plan, they wait for it, and God's like, here's the plan. You've got too many men. I want you to send 99% of them home. Right? So it ends up whittling down the forces, like 99% of the soldiers are sent away, and with the remaining 300, Gideon's going to take on the Midianites. This, again, is ridiculous, right? Like a stupid battle strategy. If you could imagine, like, in the Civil War, like, Abraham Lincoln telling, hey, let's just send 99% of the Union soldiers home, just so we can prove a point, you know, that we can do it with the remaining 1%. It would be laughable. It's a ridiculous battle strategy. But I think it's on purpose. God actually tells Gideon the reason why is lest Israel kind of think that she won this on her own strength, rather than recognize that I'm the one fighting on her behalf. All right, well, so I would suggest that in terms of strength and strategy and all, like as Israel kind of marches up to Canaan, she looks less like this and more like this, right? Like, she is extremely weak, her strategies look ridiculous, she looks like a laughingstock, like she should get her tail kicked as she steps into Canaan. I think it's significant here, think of that famous verse, be still and know that I am God, right? Like, I mean, we've heard that verse, be still and know that I'm God, and usually when we hear that verse, I tend to see it's like on a Hallmark card, and there's a beautiful picture of like a peaceful meadow, and there's like a little bench on the meadow, and the forest, and the daisies are blooming, and there's kind of this sense of go sit on the bench, like get away from the chaos and craziness of the world, sit in the calm and peacefulness, and remove yourself from the distraction, and remember that God is God, right? And I'm not saying that those things are bad, like that's fine, but it might surprise you to know that in its original context, this was actually a holy war verse. Be still and know that I am God. It comes from Israel's encounter at the Red Sea, Pharaoh and his armies. And so, context here, God has just liberated Israel out from under Egypt's empire, and they are on their way, and on the one side, they're facing the Red Sea, and so these kind of, the waters and these sort of forces of natural chaos that they would drown in. And the other side, they've got these forces of political chaos, like Pharaoh and his empire are coming bearing down upon their backs, and question is, God, we're going to get sandwiched in between. Do we drown in the water? Do we, you know, get trampled by Pharaoh? And God, what do? And Moses steps up and gives them the battle plan. He says this. He says, do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Hebrew scholars would say this is what gets picked up and carried out in the rest of the Old Testament. It's be still and know that I am God. So the imagery here is man, is one of God fighting on behalf of his weak and relatively defenseless people. Right? I think when we hear "Be still and know that I'm God," the image we should have is less that of kind of the monk up in the monastery, kind of removed away from the world. Not saying that's bad per se, but going, I think the image we should have in mind when we hear "Be still and know that I'm God," it's more like a picture of a kid with disabilities on the playground getting beat up by 10 bullies who are older, bigger, and stronger than him. Suddenly he hears his dad step onto the field and say, "Step back, son, and watch me take care of these guys for you." Right? It's a picture of God arising on behalf of this relatively defenseless people. And I think this is significant because it confronts sort of terrorism, right? Like, because the ideology of terrorism, they could go, well, we're not the strong, we're the weak fighting on behalf of God. But Israel's motto in the Old Testament is not, it's not, "We will fight for God." It's, "God will fight for us." Right? And if God doesn't, we don't stand a chance. Like, terrorism's motto is like, "We will fight for God. We'll kind of use whatever strength we can and all to fight on God's behalf." Israel is not taking on the empire for God. God is taking on the empire for Israel. This is something radically different. So, Ben Ollenberger is an Old Testament scholar who puts it this way. He says, "Every other nation in antiquity claimed that their gods participated in war and were responsible for giving their warriors victory. But only Israel came to understand this claim to mean that it was unnecessary to fight." So you've got this reality where this is, I think, radically different from cowards taking pot shots at civilians from caves with billions of dollars in international oil money and whatever else. Instead, here you have this visibly vulnerable, identifiable group of people standing out on the open battlefield, about to get crushed unless God arises and does something on their behalf. All right, well, let's move on. I'll kind of skip this because of time. Heroes. So we've seen that they don't have machine guns, they're not muscle bound, but are they heroes? What I mean by this is kind of the realm of ideology, right? That generally, when people fight holy wars or any wars, they tend to believe they're justified in fighting because of the greatness of their civilization or the greatness of their ideology that they're fighting for. So if we think back, like the Roman Empire, they believed their wars were justified by the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. There's a sense of, hey, it's going to hurt when we crush you, kind of surrounding nation, but it's going to be in your best interest in the long run because you're going to become part of the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. You're going to get folded into the glory and greatness of our civilization. And if you think of in more recent kind of history with Western colonialism and all, there was what was sometimes referred to as the white man's burden, right? Like almost a sense of, we have this duty as we go out and colonize the world to spread the greatness of our civilization, right? There was a sense that colonization and invading and collecting out resources and all those things, people could use the belief that, like, hey, we're heroes because of the greatness of our civilization and our ideology. It's kind of the way mainstream holy war works. I think, again, though, the Old Testament flips this upside down on its head. It gives us the opposite picture. For example, we see in Deuteronomy 9, this is a classic holy war passage where God tells Israel, he says, know this for certain, that as you go into the land, it is not because of your righteousness or your integrity that you are going in to take possession of the land, but on account of the wickedness of these nations, for you are a stiff-necked people. Not a very flattering term, right? Stiff-necked people. There's a sense of God going, make sure you remember that this isn't about how great you are, it's actually about how wicked this place is. Which is kind of shocking because throughout history we see that the victors write the history books. Right? What's meant by that is those who win the battle get to tell you how the battle went down. Right? And victors always tend to depict themselves as strong and heroic and courageous and noble, and always tend to depict their opponent as the opposite. But Israel moves in the opposite direction. Like, as we read the Old Testament, she constantly depicts herself as weak, fearful, idolatrous, unbelieving, dishonest, and disobedient. It's almost as if Israel hired a reporter to kind of follow her through the whole encounter and meticulously track all of her biggest flaws and failures and blast them all over the pages of the Old Testament. So Israel also doesn't have numbers. Deuteronomy 7 talks about how the Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples, for you were the fewest of all peoples. If we had more time, we'd probably go into like the significance of numbers in the ancient world. It meant a lot to show your strength and the greatness of your civilization. But in the big picture, we see that Israel doesn't justify what's going on by her greatness, her moral integrity, or her numerical strength. So what's going on here? I think if we were to zoom out again, just kind of go, what's going on at the 50,000 foot level in Israel's encounter with Canaan? I would suggest this. I think we see this picture where God is intentionally choosing the smallest, weakest, most helpless, vulnerable, powerless people he can in the ancient world in order to demonstrate to the mightiest, wickedest, bloodiest, nastiest powerhouse empires, this is the kind of God he is. That at this kind of almost like judgment day moment in history, God arises, and he arises and takes the last, the least, the fewest, the weakest, and uses them to take on the mighty, most powerful that have established their empires in arrogance against God, seeking to rule the earth without God. And God takes them down. I think the story, the classic story of David and Goliath, we can almost take as a summary of all these things, right? So when we hear David and Goliath, I think we often think of like kind of a cute children's story, right? With the flannel graph and little David here, right? But I think actually for Israel, David and Goliath was more than a cute children's story. It was a holy war story. Right? Not only a holy war story, it was the holy war story. What I mean by that is, as the battle takes place, we're told it takes place at the Valley of Elah. And this is the last place left in the promised land to be claimed. Right, and so as and so this is like what began generations ago back in Moses and Joshua's day is now coming to its consummation and fulfillment with David. And so this is like the last battle for the promised land. And so as David steps out and Goliath steps out, I think we see each of them like embodying their people in this history that's come before. Goliath, like Canaan, is this giant. Armed to the teeth, he's got the most high-tech armor and weaponry, the spear and the javelin and all the sword, all the stuff at his side. And he looks a lot like Canaan has looked like. Whereas David, in contrast, is like this relative runt, right? He can't even wear the armor because it's too heavy for him. And he goes out not with any of the traditional weaponry, but like the sling and a stone that for the ancient audience then would have just like, he's going to get his tail whooped, right? And Goliath boasts in how, hey, I'm going to fight on behalf of my gods and destroy you. Like, I'm the hero. And David flips it and says, God will fight on behalf of me and take you down. Like this whole story shows all these things we've been talking about. Goliath's got the machine guns, the muscle bound, and he sees himself as a hero. David flips all those on his head and with a sling and a stone takes down the mighty Goliath. All right, well, so as we kind of wrap up this first part of the talk, I want to give you something practical that you can kind of take home and do with this. So I want to give you the 10 steps to fight a real holy war. Right? So if you want to go out and fight a true, not just a mainstream holy war, but a true biblical holy war, I believe these are the 10 steps you can use to go and do it. Step number one is throw away your armor, right? Get away of any defense system. Step number two, burn your tactical training books. Number three, find the cheapest, most ineffective weapons you can. Number four, visit a rehab center to find military leaders with issues. Number five, hire a reporter to meticulously track all your flaws and failures. Six, boast to your enemies about how backwards your civilization is. Seven, find the biggest, baddest superpower who will surely kick your tail. Eight, pick a fight. Nine, walk into the middle of the battlefield. And 10, pray that God shows up. Like, no one in their right mind is going to fight a battle like this today, right? And so that's where I think one of the concerns people have is, man, if we believe in this violence in the Old Testament, the stuff that went down, it's going to make us more violent today. I think if we actually get a healthier, robust understanding of what's going on, it will actually have the opposite effect. No one in their right mind is going to do this unless God's the one who calls us out and is leading the charge. And I would believe I would argue there has not been anything like this in history since, but there is kind of this prophetic foreshadowing or signpost that this is of a coming battle where God will come to tear down Babylon. He will tear down the empires of our world, the powerhouse structures that stand in rebellion against Him and have sought to rule the earth without God, in order to actually liberate the weak and the vulnerable and part, those who have been crushed under the powerhouses of our world, those who have been trampled under our global economy, as an example. God hears the blood crying up from the ground today. Things like genocide and slavery and all just the horrific things that happen under the structures that we built in our world. That God is patient, but His patience will not last forever. That He is ultimately coming to tear down Babylon and establish His kingdom in its place. All right, well, I'm kind of flying through here because of time. Now I want to move to the second half, and I'll try to make this short. But I want to look at what I like to call the drastic marching orders, because I think for a lot of folks, you can kind of go, okay, well, that story helps make sense. That helps put things in perspective. But still, Israel's given some pretty gnarly commands when she goes into the land, right? So Israel is told to show no mercy, to utterly destroy them. Do not leave alive anything that breathes. If you're like me, at first glance, that can kind of sound like genocide, right? Like, is that what's going on? And indeed, critics of Christianity, like Richard Dawkins as an example, has referred to this as ethnic cleansing, done with xenophobic relish, kind of this fear of the outsider, with these bloodthirsty massacres. Is that what's going on? Well, I'd like to give kind of three paradigm shifts here that I think can at least maybe help us get a better, clearer picture of what's going on. First off, these orders are given in the context of cities, and these are, in the ancient Near East, these are military cities. What I mean by that is when you and I hear the word city today, we often think of a civilian population center, right? So we live here in Portland, and when I walk out of my front door, I see neighbor's house and kids in the front yard, and I walk down the street and there's the elementary school and there's the hospitals and the restaurants and the businesses and all that. And so when I hear the language of a city, I think of a civilian population center. In the ancient Near East, however, things were radically different. Cities in the ancient Near East were small, fortified military outposts where the soldiers were protecting and defending the roads that led up to the villages where the civilian populations lived. So the image that we should have in mind here as Israel steps in is that God is pulling down the Great Wall of China, not demolishing Beijing. He's taking out the Pentagon, not New York City. These are military defensive installations. When we hear this language of show no mercy, utterly destroy them, do not leave alive anything, it's talking about these military installations. Paul Capon is a scholar, he puts it this way. He points out, all the archaeological evidence indicates that no civilian populations existed at Jericho, Ai, and other cities mentioned in Joshua. Jericho was a small settlement of probably 100 or fewer soldiers. This is why all of Israel could circle it seven times and then do battle against it on the same day. Let's see, because of time, I think I'm going to skip through a few things here. But the big picture, we read of like kings getting taken out, right? And when we hear king, we think of like a top-notch political leader. But back in the day, these kings were more like military generals. And so the picture that we should have in mind is that Israel is attacking military strongholds, knocking out generals, and putting their soldiers to flight, not invading cities, assassinating presidents, and slaughtering civilians. Israel in the Old Testament here is taking on Napoleon and his militias, not Paris and her masses. Right? So we'll do Q&A at the end. We could get into like Rahab if we want, some things like that. Let's save that for Q&A. And there are no survivors. The fortresses have been taken over, and any defenders have either fled or been killed. Real quick, I think one of the challenges can be that we tend to our images of warfare have. Ancient warfare have largely been shaped by the Middle Ages, and the way things would happen in the Middle Ages, like when battle comes, everyone runs inside the fortress, inside the city, right? So there's a picture of all the civilians like looking inside the city for protection. But in the ancient Near East, things were different. When battles were taking place, civilians would flee to the hills and look to the fortress for protection. John Goldingay is a respected Old Testament scholar. He puts it this way. He's like, yeah, when a city is in danger of falling, people do not simply wait there to be killed, they get out. Only people who do not get out, such as the city's defenders, get killed. All right, so we've seen these are military cities, kind of the context this is happening in. Second observation would be that Israel is using what I like to call ancient trash talk, right? What I mean by that is if you look at, you can read loads of accounts from the ancient Near East of the way people talked about war. They like to use this exaggerated war rhetoric that would make kind of these broad, sweeping claims that yet were widely understood to be exaggeration and rhetoric. So, for example, you can, you know, accounts where it's like, hey, we entered the Takarimu Mountains and we cleansed it of all the people. Like, they've all been annihilated, wiped off the face of the planet. Their nation is extinct. They will never be back again. And then 1 year later, we find that the same people are back again, strong as ever, in the same mountains, causing the same problems as they ever did. This was just a commonly understood way of talking about warfare in the ancient Near East. I like to use the example of, let's say you're at a basketball game and you're in the locker room afterwards at the end and you hear the players talking about the game and they're like, man, we wiped the floor with them, we annihilated them, we slaughtered them, like they could not get a thing past us, like they had nothing on us. And if you took the talk 100% literally, you would go, man, the score must have been like 150-0, right? But then you go out afterwards and you look up at the scoreboard and you're like, okay, it was 120-105. Like it was still a significant victory, but not as drastic as the rhetoric alone would lead you to believe. And you don't go, man, why are the players lying in the locker room, right? Like, you don't think they're lying, you just recognize it's an understood way of speaking. It's kind of a rhetoric being used. Similarly, Paul Capon puts it this way. He says, we must also recognize, or I'm sorry, Christopher Wright is probably one of the most respected Old Testament scholars in the world today, and he says, we must also recognize that the language of warfare had a conventional rhetoric that liked to make absolute and universal claims about total victory and completely wiping out the enemy. Such rhetoric often exceeded reality on the ground. This is not to accuse the biblical writers of falsehood, but to recognize the literary conventions of writing about warfare. And he says this isn't to accuse them of falsehood. He's like, we're not saying that like the basketball players are lying in the locker room. We're not saying the Old Testament writers are fibbing, right? But they're using an understood rhetoric and way of speaking. And I would suggest, even if we didn't know and have all these examples of this being used in the ancient Near East, the Old Testament itself demands to be read this way. What I mean by that is there's really only two main battles where this language gets used, that's happening. One is in Joshua 9-12, the other's in 1 Samuel, spacing the chapter right now, but Joshua and Samuel. And in each of these battles, all you have to do is go a little farther in the story, and you see that the same enemies who were supposedly wiped out are back again, strong as ever, still causing loads of problems. So Joshua 9-12, for example, this is the famous story where the sun stands still and God rains down hailstones in the enemy armies. But the short version is, at the end of the battle, like it's all the 31 kings of the northern Canaan and these 30 or so kings of southern Canaan all rally their forces, and their goal is to take out Israel, and God accomplishes this great victory, saves them. And in the end, Josh was excited, and he's like, man, we did it. We utterly destroyed them. We showed no mercy. We didn't leave alive anything that breathes. He says, we took all the land of Canaan. We wiped out all the kings of Canaan. The conquest is over. Promised land is ours. He uses all this language. The problem is, we are in Joshua 12, and there's still people in Joshua 13, 14, you know, all the way into 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, into Kings. Like, it's not until the reign of David, generations later, that this thing actually gets done. If we take Joshua 12 at face value literally, the rest of the next few books of the Bible don't make sense. For an ancient Israelite audience hearing this, the only way it makes sense is to understand that he's using this recognized genre of war history. He's using this literary convention of war rhetoric. And it's not to say the Bible is lying, it's just saying when we interpret scripture, one of the first things we have to do is ask what genre is this passage in. And we're going to read apocalyptic different than we're going to read Old Testament history. We're going to read one of Jesus' parables differently from one of Paul's letters. And we recognize some of these passages being war history, ancient Near Eastern war history, it impacts how we look at it. All right, I think I was supposed to go 30 to 40, and it's been about 30, so I'm gonna try and wrap this up so we can jump into some Q&A. Final observation would be this. The primary language that's used for these battles is not killing off, but rather driving out. And driving out is the language of eviction, not murder. So the kind of drastic marching orders show up really in like only four main spots, very rare. But the language of driving the Canaanites out shows up, I believe it's over 50 times. Yeah, over 50 times in the Old Testament. And so for Canaan, like that rowdy dancer who's causing trouble and gets booted from the club, right? Like bounced from the club. Like the bad news is, yeah, you got booted. The good news is you're still alive. Similarly, I would suggest Canaan here is getting evicted from Canaan, is getting evicted from the garden. Three passages where this shows up so we can get a picture of how it's used. Deuteronomy 11 says, "The Lord will drive out all these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations larger and stronger than you." Notice how the emphasis is on God as the primary agent doing the eviction, and an emphasis on this power dynamic, how they are much larger and stronger than Israel. Exodus 23 says, God says, "Little by little I will drive them out before you, until you have increased enough to take possession of the land." And so here it's depicted as a gradual process, not an overnight ejection. Again, Joshua 12 doesn't match with this if we read it hyper-literally, right? Like, there's this picture of this gradual process of a gradual eviction. Joshua 23 says, "The Lord has driven out before you great and powerful nations. To this day, no one has been able to withstand you." Notice again how there's this emphasis on the power dynamic, how much bigger and stronger Canaan's powers are. And yet, there's also this emphasis on God being the primary agent doing the eviction. When Israel does step in and participate, it's kind of like she's just helping finish off a fight that God's brought to 99% to the point of completion. Okay, so final observation here would be that this language of driving out, this isn't the first place it shows up in Scripture. If you can kind of think of, man, are there any stories back earlier in the Bible where people are driven out from the land? And Adam and Eve is like the first place this language gets used. It's the language of exile, of banishment, of being driven from the garden. And suggest something very similar is happening here, that Adam and Eve unleash the destructive power of sin and the rebellion into God's good garden, and because of that, they're driven out. And now the powers of Canaan, God has been patient for centuries, but they have been unleashing the destructive power of their rebellion and their kind of structural rejection of God and building their kingdoms apart from God. And now the time has come where God has heard the blood that cries up from the ground, and God is ejecting, is evicting the powers from his garden. And he's given it over to the last and least nation of wandering slaves that he's identified himself with. This language gets used later in the Old Testament too for Israel herself, when she becomes just as corrupt as the powers of Canaan ever were, that Israel herself is driven out of the land. This is the language of exile. The prophets used, where Israel doesn't get a free pass, she eventually gets driven out as well. So all that to say, in the big picture, I think we have a much more nuanced, robust picture of what's happening here, and it's being driven by the goodness of God. It's just that because God is good, he is patient with the empires of our world and our kind of rebelling against God as we strive to rule the earth without God, and we unleash destruction and injustice in God's good world. But eventually God's patience runs out and he rises up to tear down the empire and to establish his kingdom in its place. We can go into some Q&A and questions and stuff now if you guys want. There's a lot usually this is about an hour, 50-minute hour, so I tried to just kind of skim the surface on a bunch of stuff, you know? So I was kind of flying pretty quick, but we could go back to any of those areas and dive deeper, or use it as sort of a jumping off point to anything you guys want to talk about.
Question?
Yes, definitely.
Excuse me. I'm going to listen yesterday morning. yeah. I haven't actually. So, have you seen there's a justification to Israel's actions against the Canaanites?
Say that one more time.
Are you saying, does Israel's actions justify?
Few thoughts, you know. So the question are, am I saying that Israel's actions are justified against the Canaanites? First off, I would say, kind of go back again, that I think the primary actor against the Canaanites in this case is God himself, rather than the Israelites, per se. I would say God is evicting the Canaanites from the land and is giving it over to the Israelites. But I do think there is a place where Israel steps in and is called to participate in the kind of consummation or completion of what's taken place. So I do believe that there's a justification here.
So we're not talking about army to army. We're talking about in Joshua 32, I believe, the elder, the children.
Say that one more time. So
in Joshua 32.
Yes.
It's elderly and children. It's not. It's women. It's not.
Elderly and children. Yes.
It's not army to army.
Great question. Yeah. So. Question of, so there's, I think, two main places where, that was one piece I kind of skipped over because of time earlier, so I'm really glad you brought that up. There are a few places, I think it's two if I remember right, where the phrase, all the men and women and children, young and old, are taken out. And so that sounds very explicitly like, dude, saying right there, women and children, young and old, right? My take on those verses, you know, Hebrew scholars would say that is called a merism. A merism is kind of an all-encompassing term or phrase that sort of uses extremes to point to those and everything in the middle. So let's say we talk about heaven and earth. Heaven and earth in Hebrew is a merism, right? It's kind of the sense of, when we talk about heaven and earth, we're not just talking about like the air and the dirt, right? We're kind of, the assumption is it's being used to refer to that and everything in between. Similarly, in Hebrew, the phrase, again, it's in the context of military cities these two times it gets used, and it says, man, when the battle was done, the fortress was destroyed, and all the men, women, and children, young and old, were out of it. They're kind of using the stock phrase, but Hebrew scholars would say that if you're an ancient Israelite and you're hearing that, you would not assume that there were necessarily women or children or elderly and all within the fortress. That the assumption would be that they're not, because again, the way ancient Near Eastern battle took place, if you were a civilian, if you were a woman, elderly, you would be nowhere near the city, you kind of would have fled away. So my kind of assumption or bent or interpretation would be, I don't know for sure, obviously, but I don't believe that those two spots actually require believing that women, the children, and the elderly were there to begin with. Now, I'm not trying to get around and say that nobody got hurt or there was no violence, right? Obviously, it's war, it's violence, but I'm saying the main point would be if in its original context, these accounts are those of military engagements rather than civilian massacres, and you bring up a really good point in question about these two verses that do, I mean, it seems to look at face value in our English translation, like, dude, that looks like a civilian massacre. But I'm saying, linguistically, to an original, in kind of the Hebrew in its original context, it would not have been read that way. They would have assumed there are no women or children or the elderly in the fort to begin with, because everybody knows they flee for the hills once the battle gets wrong. So I think the primary emphasis of those spaces, places like Joshua 32 is saying the fortresses have been demolished, the soldiers have been either been put to flight or killed, and there's nothing left inside. Like, and any people, they use this all-encompassing term, there's no people left, there's no animals left, there's no whatever. It has been desolated and destroyed.
Do we have any extra-biblical evidence, like archaeological or maybe records from any other countries or civilizations that corroborates that all of the civilians would have been evacuated? Or is this purely interpretation of?
Yeah, so in terms of these specific battles, you know, we don't necessarily have like other accounts of it, but we do have lots of accounts of other battles in the ancient Near East. And in those cases, yeah, like we see the way that warfare, so we do have accounts of the way warfare was conducted in this region in the centuries surrounding this time. And that's where, so while we don't have, like, at this battle in Joshua 32, you know, another perspective where it took place, but we do have is in this region, and over these centuries, like the way the battle took place was civilians heading for the hills rather than trying to get inside the city for protection.
So much of this story from the Old Testament is used to justify the violence that goes on in Palestine, Israel today, based on who has rights to the land. And it, as we know from watching the news, it often gets horribly violent. Is it appropriate to use this story today to justify the sort of land disputes that are going on today in Israel?
I believe strongly no. Yeah, I would argue strongly, and talk about this more in the book, but I would argue strongly that I believe it is inappropriate to use what's happening in the Old Testament to and justify Israeli presence in the land today. Now, I'm not saying that doesn't mean there may or may not be good reasons for Israel or Palestine, you know, who has rights or claims in the land today. My take would be, I think it is an extremely messy, you know, we probably all recognize it's very messy politically, and that there are claims that each side brings, and I'm not gonna claim I have the perfect answer to solve the Middle East conflict area. So I don't know the solution in terms of the conflict with Israel and Palestine today, but I do know, I believe that it is inappropriate to use these biblical passages in the Old Testament to justify Israeli presence in the land today. I think if the argument's gonna be made, I think it has to be made on other kind of pragmatic political grounds today rather than kind of a Zionist reading of the Old Testament. And part of that, a couple of reasons, but the one I point to right now would just be that what we see, all the stuff we've talked about runs so radically counter to how Israel got into the land today. You know, I think there's questions of the continuity between Old Testament Israel versus the nation state that's there today. But even you look post-World War II, 1945, it was through the powers like us, the West, that look a lot more like Canaan and Egypt, you know, are the ones who established Israel in the land versus, you know, the modern process was not this kind of weak, God arising on behalf of the weak and establishing. And this was the powerhouse empires of the world establishing a modern nation state of Israel that tends to look radically different, I think, from ancient ones in the land today. So that's all I'd say. That's a great question. And my perspective would be no, I don't believe it's appropriate to use these passages. You brought up a great question with the all men, women, and children, young and old. Another related one I kind of jumped over there, similar, was just the question of Rahab comes up sometimes because, well, dude, Rahab's a civilian, she's in Jericho, like, you know, that seems like. There is a lot of documentation in the ancient Near East that often these military fortresses had a, like, hostel / tavern kind of thing. That was usually run by a prostitute. So the hostel was, if you had people from outside the nation who were visiting, you know, that is where they would stay because the military wanted to keep an eye on them, right? Like, if you had outsiders in the land that could potentially cause trouble, the military wanted to keep an eye on them. And so often these hostels for travelers to lodge in were inside of the military fortress and all, which actually makes sense in the story of Joshua, where this is where the spies would have naturally gone, right? And often it functioned again as like a tavern where soldiers could go for beer, to unwind, to talk, whatever. And it was often run by a prostitute because unfortunately soldiers often wanted more than just beer, right? So kind of makes sense logically that you would have this place, that this would be where the spies would stay, and then it would be run by a prostitute and her family. So what I find more interesting is Rahab is actually the only civilian mentioned by name that's kind of explicitly demarcated or identified in the conquest narrative, and she is spared. So it's I think the two biggest challenges to the, you know, when we talk about the military cities, are the presence of Rahab and the phrase, all men and women, young and old, women and children, young and old. Those would be.
I've heard it before also, and you might have mentioned this when I was gone, but they would talk about, and for the foreigners among you, and for the especially blanketed like foreigners among you, like how often is that, and as a sort of argument as well, and I was wondering if you put a lot of stock in that argument. I never really dug into it much. But.
Yeah, you know, one of the things I do look at is, I do think it's interesting that there is the assumption that there will be foreigners among them in the land. I think one of the things that is kind of striking is once Israel's in the land, if you look at like the laws and all, like how many of them are designed to protect vulnerable populations, you know? So think about Israel's experience in Egypt as a nation of slaves and how much of the laws and all are to protect the welfare and well-being of the slaves, the foreigners, the widows, the orphans, those who would have been most vulnerable in that society. I believe Israel's legal code actually drastically raised the bar on how those populations were to be treated and protected under the law. And there's a side assumption that they're going to be there. But I do think there's a structural or systemic dismantling of the power structures that currently exist in Canaan in order to pave the way for that alternative society.
Well, I know you have your reading into it, and you know I read Lee Strobel, and he talks about this stuff. I just walk away with the idea that believers in this text find their own way, back door to justify something that I find unjustifiable. It is shocking to me. God, going so far to help this people against this other people. This is the same mentality that Islam has had. You know, as a former Muslim, this is how Muslim thinks, how the mind thinks. This is how basically motivates them and gets them to actually carry out these heinous acts they do. So, I mean, with all the respect to you and to everybody else that believes in this text, but I walk away with the idea that preachers and people that teach the Bible, they try to make it, they pacify the people so as they're not troubled by this text. Mm. But when you really read into it, I mean, when you really accept the text for what it says, this is unacceptable.
Thank you for sharing your perspective. So just a few, maybe just thoughts or observations. So first off, for me, I one of the things I don't want to do is say that these texts shouldn't be troubling. You know, I actually do think they should be troubling. I personally find them troubling. But I think it's helpful to try and locate where does the troubling arise, so to speak, So a few thoughts. One would be, I do think we have to recognize as we approach some of these ancient texts that we're dealing with a culture that we're thousands of years removed from in another part of the world, a different language, different stage in history, all those things. And so I think there is there should be a proper humility that we have, any of us, in attempting to understand them, not too quickly accepting just a surface glancing over the text, just skimming through. I do think that it's worthy of the work to be done of trying to grapple with what's actually going on here in interpretation. And like you said, though, I do think we have to be honest with what we find and not just kind of use, try and justify or go through the back door. I would argue fully, though, that I don't believe that this is a back door trying to pacify the text. I think it's letting them speak for themselves, but trying to hear them in the voice of their original context. And for me, where the confrontation, where the troubling piece lies, is where are we in this story, right? You know, like, because usually I think what we assume is so I would just say, as an American, all right, I find myself at the heights of one of the greatest superpowers in the world today, and in the biblical narrative, I'm the enemy in this story, right? Like, I'm the one with the target on my back at one level, and not from someone who, you know, just down below who has a problem or whatever in terms of power structure, but the target is on the back from God, you know? And so I think there should be something radically unsettling and troubling to these texts about it. I think particularly for those of us who live in the modern West or other, those at kind of the heights of power, of going, dude, God is being patient with us, with our rebellion and destruction, and personally, not to go too far into it, but man, grieving over the outcome of yesterday's election is just like one small window into a much broader sense in which I think that today we have power structures that are as arrogant as ever, as consumed by the pursuit of money and power and trampling over many in the world as ever. And I think there are people around the world who are getting trampled underneath, have been for centuries, some of the structures we've been building. And so for me, the troubling and unsettling piece is going, I find myself in the story not as the hero, but actually the one confronted by the incoming kingdom of God. That America does not have the last word when it comes to God's reign in his world. God is coming to tear down any empire, any establishment that stands against him, in order to establish his kingdom in its place. But I also find that to be a great source of hope at the same time, because from another angle, I would say one of my biggest struggles over the years had been just seeing, working internationally, seeing some of the gnarly just injustice and histories in our world, where I think so many, if God doesn't come, like, it feels like there's a lot of blood crying up from the ground around our world, and it's crying out in vain. And you just kind of go, God, where I think Israel's question was not, God, if you're good, why would you intervene? I think Israel's question was, God, because you are good, why do you wait so long? I think the hope is, and what I find in these narratives too, is that yes, God is patient. He'll often be patient for centuries. We're told with Canaan, like with Abraham, it's kind of a long story, but we're told in Genesis 15, it's 400 years that God's like, I'm being patient with the powers in Canaan. And so Abraham, you guys can't be there yet, but I'm being patient until the sin of the Amorites, the people that reaches its full extent. I think God can be patient for centuries, but for me it's actually a source of hope that eventually God's patience is done and God will arise to tear down the unjust structures of our world and establish his kingdom in their place. So I totally respect the piece you're bringing. My perspective would be that, we have to do the work of trying to hear these passages in their original context, and that there's, in my mind, it's not to pacify them. They almost become more troubling and unsettling for me, because it actually, I can't use them to go stomp down others to get what I want. You know, that's actually the kind of stuff that's being confronted here. But they're unsettling because I'm the beneficiary of a system that doesn't have the last word. God's kingdom does. And that's both confrontation and a source of hope for me as well.
Can you hear me, Josh?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I wasn't sure. It looks like my mic is muted.
Okay.
So I think you brought up a really good point. I think that when we look at the accounts in the Old Testament, we have to also make sure that we're looking at the New Testament and kind of looking at the character of God. So distressing to us, and they should be, is because we have to try to reconcile what we know about God with the way that he acts in the Old Testament. And so I think what you brought out about the fact that God is really patient, that he was patient when the flood happened. He waited and waited while the ark was being built for anyone who would come to go into the ark. And there's multiple examples in the Old Testament and the New Testament where he was waiting, and he's waiting now, but his judgment will come one day, and to wait as long as he can, and that's really amazing that he does that, but there will be a day when he has to judge. And the Old Testament peoples were so depraved. I mean, they were sacrificing their children on the altars of the pagan gods, you know, and God was still being patient and allowing them to come to repentance to him. So I think it does speak to the character of God and just how patient and loving he really is.
Yeah, ditto.
Yeah, because, you know, it is distressing, and I think it's important for people who are not following Christ to understand that it distresses us, too. There's no question about it, you know, to think that God would ask people to actually go into a society and annihilate them, or at least, you know, try to drive them from the land in a way that was not pretty. In a nice way. So it's distressing, there's no question about it.
One of the other things I look at in the book is trying to go, I think often we don't apply the same critical, like we don't apply the same critical lens that we do on the Old Testament to ourselves and our own society today. And so I look at a number of stats of just warfare in the 20th century from our hands at the West, and particularly with America and the West, and going, I think if we're talking about Israel in the Old Testament, I would say it's a caricature to say that they were like knocking down civilian population centers, massacring civilians, like all that kind of thing. Like I think that's historically, textually, all that inaccurate, you know? I think it's a violation of the expectation. But I do think you could say that of our wars, like in the last 100 years. I lay out a bunch of stats in the book, I can't remember them offhand, but we have demolished civilian population centers with fire. We have massacred people in the hundreds of thousands, like in World War II and the firebombing of Dresden and places in Germany and in Japan and the knocking out of major cities, number of things in Vietnam. Like, just kind of walk through statistically and going, we have done the caricature of that. Like, the very thing that we accuse ancient Israel of doing, we have actually done ourselves. And we're not unique in that regard. There are other powerhouses that have done similar, that have knocked down civilian population centers and massacred civilians and used the greatness of the supposed greatness of their civilization to justify it. And so I do think that one of my hopes is that we could actually take the same amount of a critical lens that we tend to target at the Old Testament and flip it and point it back at ourselves to actually take a critical look at our own civilization. I'm not anti-American, I'm proud to be an American, whatever, like, well, maybe less so today than yesterday, but that's what it is. But no, there's a sense of going, I think we often also hold the Old Testament to a much harsher standard than we do ourselves and our society today. And it can be helpful too to go, how does what we see here actually critique us and our society in this day and age?
I wish you spoke with a Christian, for the Christians in this country, not Pat Robertson.
Thanks. Well, if there's an opening for his spot, maybe you can help elect me or get me in there. That's cool. And thanks, you guys. Yeah, I do realize that, man, I feel like just because of time, like I skimmed over on the surface of a lot, you know, a lot of big stuff. And so I recognize that was kind of like skipping a rock across the surface of the water versus being able to go really deep. I actually totally forgot to bring them, but I know you guys are, you know, you're students and you have tons to read, so no expectation. But if you were interested just as a resource, I have a book, came out about 2-3 years ago, called The Skeletons in God's Closet. And this is one of the major topics that all of this and more is in there, trying to dive deeper and your citations to some of the scholarship and the stuff for that as well. And
so who's the author?
Me.
Okay. Not Norman Geisler? Okay.
No.
I can bring some copies in that
book. Okay, cool. Yeah, come back. Totally. Yeah, I should have thought that I would just give some if you wanted them, but yeah.
It's all good.
Alright.
What time is it?
It is 4:15.
So we're
done.
Any last questions or thoughts or sharing?
Any recap?
I say that one more time.
In any regard?
Any question beyond this? Yeah, I'm okay with that if you guys want to even talk about anything else.
We have until 4:30.
Yeah.
The room.
I got like a seat now if I don't need to be in front of the camera.
So the reason why I'm here, because I went from Islam to Christianity.
Yeah.
And now I'm an atheist.
Sure.
But I'm still curious and people.